I've always found these things a little confusing, glass syringes. But I discovered something about glass syringes recently that completely blew my mind. There's quite a bit of friction between the plunger and the barrel, and it needs to be because it's airtight, and you can actually hear it, like if I put it up against the microphone here. But watch what happens if I give it a spin. It just keeps going and going. Isn't that crazy? All the friction disappears. Here's a much larger one that I bought. It does the same thing. Don't be disheartened, by the way, if you try this with a glass syringe that you have lying around and it doesn't work to begin with. Sometimes they need a bit of breaking in, so give it a spin for a good few minutes first. Here's another cool thing that it does. Watch this. Boyoing. 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 It's a word. For completeness, here's a teeny tiny one. Even works sideways. So what's going on here? Well, to answer that question, let's look at what makes a glass syringe so remarkable in the first place. Compare it to a plastic syringe. With a plastic syringe, the rubber plunger tip is manufactured to have a wider diameter than the internal diameter of the barrel. So when you push it in, you're squeezing that rubber tip and it creates a really nice seal, making it airtight. And that's possible because rubber is elastic, but glass is hardly elastic at all. In fact, it's a really rigid substance. So the manufacturing tolerance on these things must be insane. Like, if you make the plunger just slightly too wide, it won't fit. If you make it slightly too narrow, it won't be airtight. And despite those manufacturing demands, I bought this for about £15. And look, it's really airtight, but also moves really smoothly. Isn't that amazing? So for a glass syringe to work, the plunger needs to be very slightly smaller than the barrel, only by a few microns. So I suppose technically they're not perfectly airtight. It's just that the gap is so incredibly small that only a minuscule amount of air could ever escape. Another criteria is that the cross-section of both surfaces need to be almost perfectly circular. If you have those conditions, then when you give the barrel a spin, something amazing happens. It turns into a hydrodynamic bearing. When a hydrodynamic bearing is rotating, there's actually no contact between the two surfaces. And we could prove that if these parts were made of metal, because we could create a circuit that passes through the syringe and then show that when the barrel is rotating, that the circuit breaks because the surfaces aren't touching. So I started to ask around to find out, does anyone have the machining ability to create something like this in metal with the kind of tolerance that you need? Someone called Patrick Hurd got in touch and said, actually, you can buy components like this off the shelf from the injection molding industry. He even sent a little video of some of the parts that he has acting as a hydrodynamic air bearing. I wish I had an air compressor. I think I'm going to buy an air compressor. I don't know if you've ever tried to buy parts from injection molding on the internet. It's really confusing, but fortunately I came across eventually someone called Tom Lipton, who has a channel called Ox Tools. Tom has this huge workshop and he makes videos showing you how to use tools, how to make tools. It's remarkable. I asked if he'd be interested in collaborating on this, and he said, well, instead of making that thing, how about we make this thing that's even more interesting? It's called a Kingsbury aerodynamic bearing. He made it and he sent it to me in the post. I'll leave a link in the card and the end screen and the description to his construction video. It's amazing what you can learn from watching someone build an object like this. So we've got this rotor plate here. This thing weighs almost 2 kilograms and it rests on these 3 tilting pads. They can tilt on these ball bearings here. I'm going to go off on a quick tangent. Look what happens when I lift the rotor off those pads. The pads stick to the rotor and they eventually fall off. That's because they're ringing together. These surfaces are incredibly flat, to a tolerance of around 100 nanometers. And You could do something similar with gauge blocks. I've got a couple of gauge blocks here. They're precision width blocks of metal, and so the end faces are incredibly flat. When you press them together, well, they stick. That's called gauge block wringing, and we can see something similar here. No one really knows for sure why gauge blocks ring together in this way, but I'll link to a 60 symbols video that goes into a bit more detail. If I try and turn the rotor, there's a decent amount of resistance because it's nearly 2 kilograms. But watch what happens when I give it a proper spin. Isn't that amazing? This thing will spin for over a minute because it's floating on a cushion of air. A cushion of air that's about 3 or 4 microns thick, according to Tom's calculations. We can actually prove the thing is floating using this device here. This is what Tom calls his octocontinuity checker, and it's just a little LED light. There's a battery inside, and some cables have been drawn out so that you can complete the circuit from the outside. Look, there we go. The light turns on when we complete the circuit. So we can feed this through the bearing to see if the circuit breaks when we spin it. This is an insulating rod, so if we connect the LED to the top and the bottom and the LED turns on, we know that's because the circuit is being completed through the bearing. In other words, the rotor is touching the pads when it's at rest. So let's spin up the rotor and see what happens. There you go, the LED turns off. As the rotor slows down, you start to see flashes of the LED as the rotor occasionally touches the pads. And those flashes increase as the rotor slows down until eventually you get a solid light and the rotor stops. Handheld bearings like this were built as a marketing tool so that salespeople could sell much larger versions for use in industry, like to support a turbine in a hydroelectric plant that might weigh hundreds of tons. The Kingsbury aerodynamic bearing and the glass syringe are examples of hydrodynamic bearings as opposed to hydrostatic bearings. A hydrostatic bearing involves injecting a fluid like air into the system. So, for example, an air hockey puck. It floats on a cushion of air because air is pushed in through holes in the air hockey table. A hovercraft is another example. But a hydrodynamic bearing is self-starting. It doesn't need an injection of fluid. So how is that possible? Let's look at the glass syringe first, and let's suppose that it's resting on its side like this. Here's an exaggerated view of the cross-section of the syringe, where the gap between the plunger and the barrel is exaggerated. You can see that the plunger is resting on the bottom of the inside of the barrel. When the plunger is at rest, there's a lot of friction between the two surfaces, but when we spin the plunger, all of that changes. And that's because air is viscous. Because air is viscous, it sticks to the surface of the plunger and it sticks to itself. That's hard to imagine in the case of air. It's easier to imagine in the case of something like honey, which is a really viscous fluid. Like if you pressed honey between two surfaces and then moved one of the surfaces, you can imagine the surface dragging the honey with it and there will be some resistance to motion. Well, the same is true for air, except that the viscosity of air is much, much lower than honey. But anyway, the point is, when the plunger rotates, it drags air with it. So as air is pulled down into this gap by the surface of the plunger, the pressure increases. And if you can spin the plunger fast enough, the pressure will get high enough to lift the plunger off from the surface of the barrel. And it's now spinning on a cushion of air. This isn't the intended use of a glass syringe, and in fact, when you're building a hydrodynamic bearing for industrial use, you're probably not going to use air, you're going to use an oil or grease. And actually, it's a balancing act with the viscosity. You don't want the viscosity to be too low because then you don't get that cushion of fluid. And you don't want the viscosity to be too high either, because that resists the rotation of the device. The Kingsbury bearing works in a similar way. The surface of the rotor drags air in between the rotor and the pads. Because the pads are able to tilt, they form a wedge-shaped cavity, which I've shown in an exaggerated form here. And it means that the air that is pulled through is forced into an increasingly narrow space. Hydroplaning or aquaplaning works by a similar principle. So does ice skating. When an ice skate runs over the ice, it melts the ice, so you have a layer of water between the skate and the ice. It's also the working principle of this playing card that I've slightly turned the end up of. The original Hyperloop concept was based on this idea as well, though it isn't anymore. So there you go, the hydrodynamic bearing crops up in all sorts of strange places. Thank you to Patrick Hind, and a big, big thank you to Tom Lipton for his help on this video. Don't forget to watch his video on the subject and the rest of his channel. The links are in the description. All right, I'm back with a few more Blinkist recommendations. They're sponsoring this video. Blinkist does something remarkable. It condenses non-fiction titles into 15-minute reads. They're also narrated, so you can listen to them on your commute. It's a great way to get a summary of the main ideas within a book. Very often you want to read the whole book after you've read the summary, so it's a great way of getting a taste for a book before committing to the whole thing. It's also just a great way of getting loads of information really quickly. So here's some recommendations. Factfulness by Hans Rosling and some other Roslings. Hans Rosling's that guy who did those amazing visualizations of world health, and the book is also really interesting. The Magic of Reality, Richard Dawkins. Collapse by Jared Diamond, you know, that's the fall of civilizations. Just such an interesting thing to think about. And on a different note, Getting Things Done by David Allen. If you can master GTD as a method, that's amazing. They also have some really great full audiobook titles now that you can get a lot cheaper than anywhere else. The first 100 people to use my special URL, blinkist.com/Steve Mould, will get 1 week absolutely free, no strings attached, cancel whenever you like. It's an opportunity to find out whether it's for you. If you do want to carry on, you get 25% off full membership. The link is also in the description, so check out Blinkist today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe, and I'll see you next time.